Hello friends, welcome to the another lecture on air pollution and solid waste management. And today we will see the topic air sampling. It is one of the method of control air pollution. And in the previously we have seen that the content like causes of air pollution, then effects of air pollution, the specific effects of air pollution on human body and other living organisms, then control measures, then condensation, evaporation, a lot of things we have seen previous lectures. So before starting today, I would like to introduce myself. I am Amay Khedikar, working in the Department of Civil Engineering at Tulsi Ramji Gaikwad Patil College of Engineering and Technology. So we'll begin up with the air sampling today. So our today's topic is the air sampling. So basically, what does it mean? We'll stand with it. So air quality, air index, in previous lecture, we have seen the air quality index where the values ranging from 150 to 500 and its impact on human beings and the nervous system, we have seen that. So in the air sampling, the first content we'll see that the what is air quality, how we can define the air quality. Complicated by a lack of knowledge as to what is clean and what we mean by quality, okay. So it is somewhat complicated now, so we'll deal one by one. Main reason for air pollution control program is to protect public health, define air quality based on its effects on people and the environment. That is the main challenge also, okay. Effects of air pollution are chronic and are not immediately obvious. It takes some time to proper impact on the body, and it has a chronic effects, okay. And this entire segment is all about the public health. So, and this term is very complicated, that what exactly and what do you mean by air quality. So measurement of air quality generally falls into three categories: then measurement of emissions, meteorological measurement, and ambient air quality, okay. There are a lot of meteorological parameters we will discuss further, we will discuss later on, but we'll now first of all we'll first focus on the measurement of emissions. So what are the pollutants are emitting around us and what may be the harmful impact, that we will see. It is also called as the source sampling. There is a source of sampling. When a particular emission source is measured generally by on the spot test, so that is the source sampling generally occurs when or found when the particular emission sources is measured, okay, generally by on the top spot test. Then meteorological measurement, which known for the factors that show how pollutants are transferred from source to recipient via few meteorological parameters that these are, you know, transferred from the particular source to the human beings or the participants, okay. Then ambient air quality, which measures the quality of the air in the particular place. Almost all the evidence of health effect is based on these measurements, okay. Also we have the industrial hygiene sampling and residential indoor sampling. Then for testing of the air quality inside the factories and work and phases of the work, we must have the industrial hygiene. We must maintain the industrial hygiene. Even the to evaluate the quality of air in living spaces, we must have the residential indoor sampling also, okay. Now we'll focus on that techniques which is used. So most of air pollution monitoring equipments performs the act of sampling and analysis in one action, real time measurement. That is real time measurement. Now older equipments, intermediate sampling, a time lag between the sample was obtained and when data was available. Almost all gaseous pollutants are monitored by real-time analysis. Particulate pollutants are still most monitored by intermediate sampling, even though real-time method are available. Okay, so most of the air pollution monitoring equipments perform the act of sampling and analysis in one direction and real-time measurements. Almost all gaseous pollutants are monitored by real-time analysis. Particulate pollutants are still mostly monitored by intermediate samplings. Older equipments, time lag between the sample was obtained and when data was available, okay. Air sampling techniques. When obtaining a sample for air pollution analysis, when we obtain any sample for analysis, should be sufficient sample for analysis. That sample should be sufficient enough, which is the minimum requirement of analysis. Most pollutants very low levels and requires a large volume of gas for accurate measurement. Then pollutants in very small quantities are easy to contaminate. Take care of purge sampling containers if grab samples are used. And collection and analysis limitations may require collection over extended period, means data may only be a 24 hours average. Real-time produces so much data are often set to give hourly average to make data more understandable. See, whatever data we have of emission, it should be of last 24 hours only to have proper interpretation and proper analysis. Okay, then collection and analysis limitation may require the collection over extended period, means data may only be of last 25 hours, average data. Then pollutants in every very small quantities are easy to contaminated, so we have to take care of large particles. Again, and the sample should be of sufficient quantity, okay. Then it requires gases or particulates to be drawn to the surface of a collecting medium or a sensor. Sampling trains, which may include a vacuum pump, vacuum trap, a flow regulator, and a collecting device or sensing unit. Sampling trains for gases may also utilize filters to prevent particles from entering the collecting unit. That is a very important aspect. This system, which is a part of that, in which the requires gases or particles to be drawn to the surface of collecting medium or a sensor. And sampling trains, which may include a vacuum pump, vacuum trap, a flow regulator, and a collecting device and a sensor unit or obliquely a sensor unit. Sampling trains for gases may also utilize filters to prevent particles from entering the collecting units. You can see the entire things. In a sampling vessel, you can see the sampling tube where absorbing solution is there. Then vacuum trap, the limiting orifice, the vacuum pump. It is a systematic diagram showing the air sampling system. Okay, vacuum pump, then the limiting orifice, a vacuum trap is looking there, then sampling vessel, sampling tube, absorbing solutions. So that is the example, and that is the what can I say, the section of the entire system, air sampling system. Okay, now the procedure. Conducted by a static grab intermediate or continuous procedure, first air monitoring use static sampling, simple and cheap. Requires days of data, example deposit gauge. Grab sampling is not commonly used to monitor ambient air quality, uses bladders and springs. Okay. Basically, the procedure consists of the bistatic grab intermittent or continuous procedure. This process is continuous. Then first air monitoring is to be done, and which is for that we use the static pump sampling, simple and cheap in nature. Requires day for data, deposit gauge. Okay. In the site selection, in the following things are very much important as far as the site selection for air sampling. The first one is we must be very clear with the purpose of the monitoring. Then numbers and data of instrument required. We must have database. We must have proper analysis. We must have the entire schedule or entire costing of the all instrument required and the infrastructure available. And duration of the measurement. We must have proper knowledge of the duration. Then best available general guidelines from AS2922. We must have proper guideline and entire booklet. And we have to take care that it should be easily accessible. Okay. So the purpose should be very clear. Then number of instruments and all the required, we must have a knowledge of that. Then duration of the measurement, we must be able to know that. Then best available general guidelines from AS2922 and should be easily accessible. Okay. Now. Just now in the beginning, I have told you that there are some meteorological factors such as wind, temperature, photochemical reaction, rain. These are the also medium from where the pollution can travel from source to participant. So now we'll see the meteorological monitoring, how we monitor the meteorological parameters, factors. Now the changing weather conditions can produce dramatic changes in air quality and ambient pollution level. Okay. So as we are aware, and we can see that sudden change in the weather or sudden change in temperature may leads to a lot of uneasiness to all kind of things. Then changing weather conditions can produce dramatic changes in the air quality. and ambient pollution levels also. Factors such as wind dispersion rates, velocity and direction, then temperature inversion, sudden rise, sudden decrease, these may also affects, then photochemical reactions and rain. So these are a few meteorological parameters that we need to monitor as far as air sampling is concerned. Now, we must have proper choice of the equipments. We must have proper choice of equipment. So for almost every type of air pollution, there are several different acceptable methods of analysis. The type of equipment and methodology used for analysis may be determined by many factors such as cost, number of data points required, and the purpose for which data are being used, the time interval required between data points, the device's power requirements, the type of air pollutants, and the environment in which the monitoring equipment is being placed. So while selecting a monitoring equipment, we must have a knowledge of all the things just now mentioned. You can see on your slide also. So for every type of air pollutant, there are several different acceptable methods of analysis. We need to choose the proper one with our best of knowledge and by studying all database. The type of equipments and methodology used for analysis may be determined by many factors such as cost, number of data points available, then purpose. The purpose should be very clear. The objective should be very clear for what we are installing the equipments. Then time interval required, then device power requirements, then type of air pollutant it is, and the environment, first of all, in which we are going to monitor it. That is very important. Now there are some pollution prevention strategies where the pollution prevention versus control offers important economic benefits and at the same time allows continuous protection of the environment. So as far as pollution prevention and pollution control is concerned, so more than control, prevention offers a lot of economic importance. And it comes with a lot of economic benefits and at the same time allows continuous protection of the environment. While most of the pollution control strategies cost money, pollution prevention has saved many firms thousands of dollars in treatment and disposal of cost. So this method of method of prevention than controlling, it come along with a lot of saving in the cost. This strategy saves cost, and a huge amount of money can be saved, and the treatment and disposal cost also can be saved. And most importantly, pollution prevention should be viewed as a means to increase the company productivity also. So in the corporate sector, it is very much important. And by reducing the amount of raw material that are wasted and disposed of, manufacturing process become more efficient, resulting in a cost saving to the company. So the amount of raw material that we are wasted and disposed of, so manufacturing process become more efficient in that segment, resulting in the cost saving and increasing in the productivity of the company. Okay. Then pollution control, pollution prevention should be the first consideration in planning for the processes that emits air contaminants. Undertaking pollution prevention practices may reduce air emission enough to allow the businesses or industry to avoid classification as a major air emission source. So there has to be certain bylaws, there has to be strict rules regarding that. Hence, the pollution prevention should be the first consideration while establishing any industry or allowing any industry and which is in planning for processes that emits air contaminated. Undertaking pollution prevention practices may reduce air emission enough to allow a businessman or industry to avoid classification as a major air emission sources. So that is also a very important aspect to consider as far as industry setups are concerned. Now, what is prevention? None of you always say prevention is better than cure. So what is prevention? Now we'll focus on the particular. What is pollution prevention? Pollution prevention is a elimination or prevention of wastage in terms of air emissions, water discharges, solid hazards, waste at the source. In other words, pollution prevention is eliminating wastage before they are generated. So it is all about the elimination process of waste. That is the pollution prevention. Pollution prevention approaches can be applied to all pollution generating activity, hazards and non-hazards, regulated and unregulated. Pollution prevention does not include practices that creates new risk of concern. So basically the pollution prevention is all about the removal of the pollutants, okay, and removal of any pollutants like hazardous, non-hazardous, solid, liquid, you know, all the things, you know, it's eliminating waste before they are generating. So we are not allowing them to become harm or become bad for us. So bad for our, bad for society, bad for anything. Pollution prevention approaches can be applied to all pollution generating activity, hazards and non-hazards, regulates that unregulated. Pollution prevention does not include practices that creates new risk of concern. So this bylaw, this rule is also this also produces or promotes the fact that it does not provide a practice or does not include a practice that create new risk of concern. Okay. Now there is a Pollution Prevention Act. Okay. In 1990, the US Congress established federal policy on pollution prevention by passing the Pollution Prevention Act. The Act states that pollution should be prevented or reduced at the source whenever feasible. Source reduction. Pollution that cannot be prevented should be recycled in an environmentally safe manner whenever feasible. Okay. Third, pollution that cannot be prevented or recycled should be treated in an environmentally safe manner whenever feasible, and disposal or other releases into the environment should be employed only as last resort and should be conducted in an environmentally safe manner. Okay, so in 1990 US firstly they have established with the federal policy regarding air pollution. Then there are four points we have just seen now, in which the prevention should be taken to reduce at the source whenever feasible. The proper prevention has to be taken to reduce the air pollution, it is suggested. Then the pollution that cannot be prevented, for example, we are not about to control the pollution, then that case the recycled in an environment safe manner. So we need to recycle it. The source has to recycle it whenever it is feasible. And pollution that cannot be prevented or recycled, in both the cases, neither it can be recycled neither nor it can be prevented, so that should be treated in environmentally safe manner whenever feasible. Okay, and then disposal, the main thing as far as disposal is concerned, or other phases into the environmental, should be employed only as the last resort and should be conducted in an environmentally safe manner. So in every segment they are told that it should be treated in an environmentally safe manner, so that it cannot be cause harm to other societies. Okay. Then Pollution Prevention Act defines about the source reduction, recycling, energy recovery, treatment and disposal are not considered pollution prevention under the Act. Okay, so these are the segments which is not covered there. Basically recycling, energy recovery, treatment, disposal, so these are some lacunas there, okay, which defines basically pollution prevention as source reduction, but recycling, energy recovery, treatment and disposal are not considered pollution prevention under the Act. Okay. Then source reduction, in that the product changes, and then the designing and producing a product that has less environmental impact, then changing the composition of product so that less hazardous chemicals are used as a result from the production, using recycled material in the product, that is one of the best practice of using the recycled one, reusing the generated scrap and excess raw material back in the process, minimizing product filter and packaging, producing goods and packaging reusable by the consumer, producing more durable products. So these are some the reductions, source reduction factors. By using such kind of things we can reduce some amount, okay, of pollution. So product changes are essential, then designing and producing a product that has less environmental impact. So if we have to design a product in a such a way that it should have a less impact on the environment, then composing a product we have to change if it is found hazardous, then recycled material should be used, one of the best practices, then reusing generated scrap and excess raw material back in the process, then minimizing the products, filter and packaging, then producing goods and packaging reusable by consumer. Even the not only the source but also consumer has to think of reuse, and producing more durable product. Use and throw concept should not be there. So more durable products are there, then we need to go for that. Okay. Now some input material changes. Material substitution, using a less hazardous or toxic solvents for cleaning or as air coating. then purchasing raw material that are free of trace quantities of hazardous and toxic equipment. While purchasing, we have to take care that it should be free from toxic impurities, or it should not be hazardous one. That precaution we have to take. Okay. And then equipment and process modification, in that changing the production process or flow of material through the process. Then replacing or modifying the process equipment, piping or layout, using automation, changing process operation conditions such as flow rates, temperature, pressure, and residence times, and implementing new technologies. Okay, so these are the few things we need to inculcate in terms of equipment and process modifications. Then changing production process, we need to implement eco-friendly production process. Then replacing or modifying process equipment, piping the layouts, okay, piping layouts. Then using automation, where we can save time and we can have proper efficiency. Error can be resolved before execution only. Changing process operation conditions such as flow rates, so, and implementing new technologies. See, new technologies we need to implement, okay. There are some good practicing practices such as institution management and personal programs such as employee training or employee incentive program that encourage employee to reduce waste. There has to be some incentive, there has to be some training program for the employees to reduce the waste. There has to be teaching, training session, brainstorming session in any private firm or any organization. Performing good material handling and inventory control practices that reduce loss of material due to mishandling, expired, shelf life, or improper storage. And we have a lot of improper storage sometimes. You know, we need to reduce that. Preventing loss of material from equipment leaks and spills. Then segregation of hazardous waste from non-hazardous waste to reduce the volume of hazardous waste disposed. See, we, for example, we are keeping the all kind of waste together. So we need to segregate the hazardous and non-hazardous waste separately so that the volume of the hazardous waste can be disposed earlier, okay? Then institutions should have policies. There are some brainstorming session guidelines or some incentive schemes by the government to the organization, those who produce less kind of waste, okay? Then using standard operating procedures for purpose of operation and maintenance task, avoid repetitions, performing preventive maintenance checks to avoid expected problems with the equipment, then turning off equipment when it is not in use, unnecessary power is being wasted, improving or increasing simulation on heating or cooling the lines. And in the last, you can see the highlighted one, the environmentally sound reuse and recycling. The concept of reuse and recycling should be adopted globally. That is a very important and very useful, fruitful content for the air pollution or to reduce the air pollution. Okay. There are this previously we have also seen the control of gases pollution like adsorption, oxidation, reduction. So primary application in the organic gases, example SO2, it ultimately tells about the mass transfer from gas to liquid. Contaminated, it dissolves in liquid. Liquid must be treated. So this is all about the absorption. Smartly we will see. You can see the inlet, okay, where the liquid is out and where the gas is out. The liquid in from the right side, you can see that where shell are there, trail are there. So there, where the gas and the liquid are being separated from top and the bottom respectively. This is the image of the plate tower, okay. This is a packed tower. You can say the liquid in, then it is subjected to packing of the restrainer, then liquid redistributor, and then packing supports, then gas in, and then liquid out. So this is a phenomenon happens there. Then adsorption, the primary application in organic gases, example, trichloroethanol, ethylene, then mass transfer from gas to solid, contaminated is bound to solid, and absorption may be generated, okay. Then common absorbents, activated carbon, silica gel, activated alumina, zeolites, molecular sieves. You can see that contaminant molecules in step one, diffusion to absorbent surfaces. Then step two, migration into pores of absorbent. And step three, monolayer buildup of adsorbates. It is get absorbed in the third step. This is again process of absorption zone, where A, B, C, D shows the absorption zone. In the first, you can see that the cycle, the volume of influenced, okay? It is going through a breakpoint where the breakthrough curve you can obtain there. influent concentration. Then oxidation, thermal oxidation, catalytic oxidation. A thermal oxidizer or thermal oxidizer is a process unit for air pollution control in many chemical plants that decomposes hazardous gases at a high temperature and releases them into the atmosphere. Thermal oxidizers are typically used to destroy hazardous air pollutants and volatile organic compounds from industrial air streams. These pollutants are generally hydrocarbon based, and when destroyed via thermal combustion, they are chemically changed from CO2 and H2O. In thermal oxidation, where the application is organic gases, autogenous gases, 7 mg per kg, this is the heat value. The operating temperature is 7 to 1300 degrees Celsius. Efficiency 95 to 99 degrees Celsius. Efficiency is 95 to 99%. Byproducts must not be more hazardous, and heat recovery is economical and necessity. Okay, you can see that. You can see on the right side the inlet for contaminated stream where the burner block is there. The gas burner piping is fitted over there. In the middle, you can see the burner pot, refractory ring baffles, refractory line, steel shells. Okay, these are the things. Now, catalytic oxidation. Catalytic oxidation is a relatively recently applied alternative for the treatment of VOC in air streams resulting from remedial operations. The addition of catalytic accelerates the rate of oxidation by absorbing the oxygen and the contaminant on the catalyst surface, where they react to form carbon dioxide, water, and hydrochloric gases. The catalyst enables the oxidation reaction to occur at a much lower temperature than required by a conventional thermal oxidation. Okay, then the application is again organic gases, then non-autogenous gases, 7 mg per kg. Then temperature, operating temperature is 250 to 425 degrees Celsius, and efficiency also 90, it varies from 90 to 98 degree. The efficiency also varies from 90 to 98%, and it may be poisoned, and heat recovery is normal. Okay, then CSR, selective catalyst reduction, in that the NOx control ammonia is reducing agent. Okay, injected into exhaust, NOx is reduced to NO2 in a separate reactor containing where 4NO plus it involved with the 4NH3 plus oxygen, which results to 4NO2 plus 6H2O. And twice NO2 plus 4NH3 along with the oxygen results to 3NO2 plus 6H2O. Okay, then some control particular, then spray chamber, cyclone, bag house, venturi, export, that we have seen. They have the sludge, spray fluid, you can see there, the clean air, mist separator, air and particle, the sludge. Okay, spray chambers are there, the primary collection mechanism, initial impersion of the particle into water droplets, the efficiency more than 1% for 1 um diameter. Then okay, it is pressure drop 0 to 5 from 1.5 of H2, water droplet size range from 50 to 200 um. This is all about spray chamber. The spray chamber applications, the quick wet corrosive or liquid particle, example chrome plating bath, paint booth over spray, explosive or combustible particles, stimulative particles, gas removal. You can see here the dust. When see, I have shown you the motion in a pink color, that the clean gas and dirty gas, clean gas is released from the above and the dust is settling down in the bottom, and the dirty gas, you can see, which is entered from that, where the clean gas releases from the top and the dust is settling down with the action of gravity from there. This is the example of cyclone. In multiclones for high gas volumes, primary collection mechanism, centrifugal forces carries particles to wall, and efficiency also greater than 50% for 1 um diameter and less than 95 for 5 um diameter. Okay, pressure droplets 8 to 12 centimeter of H2 application is there for dry particles, fly ash, pre-cleaner, sawdust, liquid particles following venturi meters. This is the best example of bag house now. You can see the outlet, the inlet, okay, the filter bags are there. Then the clean air inside, which is moving out from the outlet. Okay, the dust is settling down. Okay, these are the things now. In the bag house, in the particle collection mechanism, where screening, then the impaction and electrostatic. Okay, so these are the things in bag house. Efficiency also, you can see in the slide, 99.5% for more than 1 UM diameter, less than 99.8% for less than 5 meter diameter. In fabric filter materials, natural fibers, cotton and wool, temperature limit 80 degrees Celsius. Synthetics, then temperature limit 90%, fiberglass temperature 260 degrees. Okay, then diameters are then cleaning shaker, reservoir, pulse jet, okay, pressure drops 10 to 15 centimeter of H2, all these things. Then applications of bag house and dry collection, fly ash, then grain dust, fertilizers, may be combined with the dry absorption media to control gas emissions, especially CO2. Okay. So I hope guys you understood the concept of air sampling. We have seen various methods, we have seen various equipments, you know, bag house, then cyclone, and process spray chamber, control, all the things. So I am just taking the recap of all the things. Then air sampling, then adsorption, oxidation, you know. All these are the things we have seen. And then monitoring meteorological parameters such as wind, temperature, rain, all the things. And procedure, air sampling system, all the Indian techniques we have seen. So I hope you understand this, and the air sampling is having very much importance, even Pollution Control Act we have seen. So I hope you understand this, thank you very much for watching very patiently, and we'll meet very soon in our next video. Thank you.